how do we bridge the gap between our bad behavior now and where the society needs to be to come back into alignment with our values.
Can you say that again?
She started talking, I think, 40 minutes into that video. I can't remember her name, but
sorry,
she's way, way far down. If you YouTube, if you're not in the chat room, if you can use that link.
Yeah,
is
that Carla? Yes. Yeah. He has to post it, Jack a lot. Is that the one that's named?
Yeah, if you YouTube search Jack a lot, FMRI, mind reading in YouTube, there's several videos that come up. You're looking for the one that's, I think, about an hour and 45 minutes, or an hour and 50 minutes. He only talks about 25 or 30 minutes, and then the gal comes in about 40 minutes, and she talks for 15 or 20 minutes. You know, for the ethical piece, that's a good beginning place for TIs to look at. She brings up a lot of important ethical questions. And that should be part of, you know, what we know as TIs. And then, like you say, there are ethics professors at every university. You know, it would be much for us to draw up a letter that discusses the ethical implications of this, you know, one page, and then mail it off to these professors, and that will get them their first introduction to, yeah, okay, there really are people who are making the same complaints, like they did in the 50s and 60s about the MKUltra testing before the hearings came along. So, you know, when it does come up again, you know, they have that seed that's been planted there that they have some exposure to it. That's, you know, another, you know, kind of line of effort that would be good for our group, I think.
Well, I mean, but the problem with the universities is they frame the whole study of it. I mean, I think it's a little skewed. And
yeah, they're paying to tied to getting the money, you know, getting the research grant.
But it's pretty stunning. There are a lot of these courses now at universities. Robots and manned vehicles, enhanced physical attributes, you know, soldiers, some of these subjects, grammar of killing, technology, the new way of war. I mean, it just goes on and on. I mean, I just don't think this is a good chapter in human history.
Yeah, okay, I'll link another one here. This is not our topic, but this is the reality. The TI should be able to reach this book and understand, you know, where we are. It talks about artificial intelligence and, you know, what happens when an artificial intelligence becomes as smart as a human being, and how the, you know, 11 days later they're smarter than, you know, the entire combined cognitive power of every human that ever lived. And that, you know, this century, you're not going to see 100 years of growth. You're going to see 200,000 years worth of growth because of, you have machines that, you know, on a recursive formula are able to increase their cognition. And that's the reality of where we're at. So I absolutely agree. It's a very dangerous situation. You have very smart people. Stephen Hawking, Elon Musk have both said, hey, you better watch out. Artificial intelligence is something you're the smartest person in the world has, you know, like an IQ, what, 200, maybe a little bit more if they can measure it. And you're talking about something that can, you know, imagine and think of things that, you know, is beyond the capability of human beings. So that's a real danger. And so in a sense, you know, I can see how they would want to look here into the minds of humans as a means of, you know, in the United States, you got to be the first one there. You got to be on the forefront of the research. You can't let China do it. You know, you can't let Russia do it. That makes your army, your navy, and you know, all your research completely useless. You know, because they'll have cyber warfare techniques that will be able to shut you down, and you know, without firing a shot, they can counter you. You know, that's a pretty powerful weapon to has something that's smarter than your entire research base. That's kind of where our power as a nation flows from, is the scientists, engineers,
it is like the Matrix. I mean, the first one.
Yes.
I mean, where, Neo gets plugged into that, whatever, and they get, you can do that just as soon.
It's so weird when you learn that some of these things are not science fiction. It's,
it is.
Very humbling. What can I do? What should I do in that situation?
I won't go into my own personal experience on that, but
I've experienced some of that, and it's very if you want to, there's a in Project Soulcatcher, I think Dr. Duncan talks about the digital mind space, and they talk about how when they had these guys that were having just terrible seizures, and they they were doing lobotomy and stuff, and then they found out that if you cut the corpus callosum, which is the connective circuitry between the two halves of the brain, that they would have this weird after effect that, like, their left hand and right hand, they talk about a girl's trying to pick out whatever dress she's going to wear, she picks out with the right hand, the other hand is independently going and making a decision on its own, and this is all published now. You've got a frontal lobe that's the center of executive function, but you have different parts of the brain based on evolution that are doing different things. Largely redundant, left and right, right brain. There are some things that happen only on either side, but what they had said is there's basically two people in one mind, and expounding on that concept, that's where the hive mind comes in. In Miguel Nicolelis' unclassified work out of Duke University, where he has hive-minded rats and monkeys, and it's a topic of discussion. They said that they've been able to tether three or four people together and work in a hive unit. They've been able to get a little bit more success working out problems. You get too many of them out there, it becomes like a schizophrenic brain that's unable to the hive mind, four different people, tied in together, aren't able to make a correct function as well as they should, but,
transhumanism.
Yeah. And
which is just, to me, it's horrifying. I mean, I'm sure, 20-year-old KK guys think it's really cool, but.
Yeah. Well, the other piece was, when automobiles came around, I had a project where we had to go back and look through the microfiche, and when the automobiles started hitting the streets, what were the reactions in the newspapers? People were worried about women losing their pregnancies, or you go over 40 miles an hour, your face would peel off. There's always fear when a new technology comes about, but the bottom line is, to compete in the market, you have to adopt the new advantage, or you'll be left behind. So you don't see people still doing their research papers with the Encyclopedia Britannica, going to the library. They use Lexis Texas and Google searches, and they make better grades than somebody who do the hard work of walking through a library. It's something that happens. You know, they adapt.
Well, people's faces didn't get cooled off.
Our thing is, brain damage, so we're with PIs, we can interface with the computer without needing a keyboard or a mouse.
You may know that. I don't know. But I just think we got to stay away from being too scared of all this. It's so technical and so scary. And like I say, the faces didn't feel off 40 miles an hour, so hopefully this won't mush them into
I'm not trying to scare. I just don't want to do that.
No, I'm sorry. Hey, Stella.
I have sometimes a problem with that because I start reading about the extent. It's so extensive. I don't think people understand that they I don't like any part of it. I don't want to be enhanced, you know?
I agree with you, Bella. That's right, it's enhancement. And this is great looks like it's your touch, your spirit of the mind. And you talk about a lot of the technology. A lot of people speak about it with excitement.
Yeah.
Our perspective, especially if we've been implanted with it, it's not so exciting. It's kind of a terrorizing to think where we're going. And I don't mean to be negative, I'm just, you know.
It's a biggie. I mean, you have to ask yourself that question, you know.
Maybe right. Maybe.
You know, like, where is this going? It's so far advanced, and it's so
complicated into everything. I think enhancement, say, like, enhancement will become, you know, it is the future, because let's say that, you know, my niece and nephew go to work. Well, someone at work has a tip that, you know, they have access to the internet and everything. It's going to perform better.
Right.
And provided it's successful, the person with the chip has access to everything or the hive mind, whatever. And so if you want to stay competitive in your job, you're going to end up adopting some of these enhancements just so that you can remain competitive in the workforce, I believe.
Absolutely. I mean, it's just like the steroids in sports. I think people have used that analogy. You know, all these sports, I mean, you could tell they were taking steroids, and if you're not using them, you lose. So, I mean, so everybody starts taking steroids, and,
right.
You know, everything becomes more extreme. You know, it's got to be more dangerous, and if you're not more dangerous, you know, it just keeps going on and on. With this technology,
And they have
genetic modification.
I mean, they're trying to make robots. They want robots to be basically, you know, have the senses of a human, the hearing, the sight,
and to be able to download someone's consciousness.
So why don't you use a human to do that?
I think it was the natural progression. They started doing this stuff. You know, everybody. You can look up Jose Delgado stopping the bull, you know, back in 1963. And then, they talked about how he was doing the wireless human-machine interface using radio waves back then. I mean, you could find that stuff. And so it's just a matter of the Soviets are doing it, the Chinese are doing it, you know, the Brits are doing it. If we don't do it, I mean, we you know, they can wipe us out. You know, it's like the next big weapon.
And I
was once apartment over from this technology, and they had, you know, those guys that are working with it and know about it but are sworn to secrecy, they have problems with it too. You know, they have the moral and ethical struggle with it. And, you know, one of the things that they would do best is they would try to come up with a way to get you to think about it without violating that agreement. So they always said, you know, it's right. Actually, Dr. Duncan has in his book, they did a professional knowledge question. You know, when you're training your new officers, they asked us why academics are only allowed to use fixed ray radars from the zenith, to, you know, from the azimuth up to 20 degrees off. Why is that? And, you know, they would never tell you the answer because, you know, the junior officers, you know, the department had to ask you that question, but the junior officers, you know, they would never tell you if you were right, but they would want to get you to think about it. And I think that was kind of their way of spilling information without breaking any agreements, because there are ethical issues, and it is the right thing to do to try and engage the public on this topic, especially when it's being used in nefarious manner.
Absolutely. I mean, we need, you know, whistleblowers, which is why our president is coming down hard on them. I mean, like Dr. Duncan, I mean, he published this stuff. I guess it's all unclassified now. But I wonder why more people aren't speaking out that have been involved in that.
Because they give them more information. They have more information than we do. And some of the weird stuff that we see, they let them know. Some of the, you know, it's, they just have more information and they think that their answer is correct. And that's kind of the thing, that there's probably more to this. I don't think that being the existence of a living AI, an artificial intelligence that is comparable to a human intelligence or greater than human intelligence, that's a huge thing that they would want to keep secret because it's such a powerful weapon that can cause so much destruction, that they would be willing to risk the, you know, however many, whatever, you know, 4,000 of us that are being tortured with this or whatever the number is. The destruction that could wreak if there were, you know, some sort of transnational corporation that was unscrupulous and got a hold of the technology.
That would never happen. Without all this, we don't need this stuff. We don't need this technology. I find it just pretty much destructive in every way. And I'm not a Luddite. Anyway.
I think this goes back to...
to own
Yes, I
here, the surface of the planet in a very thin atmosphere which covers the Earth. It's a rare situation that we have, and it's extremely fragile. So even if they dig down 3 miles under the mountain and put their labs down there, or if they have installations on the far side of the moon, this is the place that we have. And this is the only place we have right now. They discover planets on other solar systems and other galaxies which have some of the same makeup, they're not going to get there. This is it, you know? This is all we have right now. So I'm saying that for everyone to hear, but also all of your wiretappers, all of your predators, all of your military people, all of your intelligence agents and agencies, you know, wake up. This is it, you know? We have to turn this thing around, because it's only a short time before things can be put out of balance. At a critical mass point, things can collapse. They can just absolutely collapse on us, and we won't be able to recover. So, I mean, it's a warning as well. It's a blessing to be alive right now, and we should appreciate it as much as we can. You know, my targeting is increased tremendously in the last few years, and I'm pretty sure they're going to try to finish me off soon. So I don't know how many times I'll be able to express my gratitude for having life. I'm also getting some very desperate texts and emails from people from this community. I don't know if they're on tonight, but a lady in Ohio has been hospitalized. She's down to 87 pounds. And she is disabled, so she doesn't know how much time she has left. This is real, you know? This is real. And so everyone has to get, you know, I don't want people to be more afraid, but I want people to have more gratitude for what they have, you know, for as long as we have it. That's just basically what I want to say.
I agree. I mean, it's why I don't approach my family and friends with this, because I want that, those relationships with them. And I'm afraid I'll lose them if I
I have a question. This is Bonnie in California. And my question is, what happens when the machines take over? Because we're not very intelligent, as you all know. What happens when the machines take over?
The machines can't take over. They need operators.
For now. But I can see in the future. Their brains being able to speed ahead faster than ours. That's a state.
Well, I don't think we can address that. that's a little beyond our grasp.
It is not science fiction, meaning, we have a limitation, but the brains may not be as limited. The machines may not be, their brains may not be as limited.
Right.
At a certain stage.
My favorite movie used to be iRobot.
Non-TI, see where I can get, you know, somebody, you know, a group of people, 100 or 1,000 people that, you know, have been briefed in on this topic and have been provided the books and materials for the subject, and then try to use those people to maybe do like a YouTube video that describes the basics of the topic. And so that people can see that, you know, there are people talking about this, And then when, once we have a body of, you know, a body of a sort of evidence to present to a family member, we would train individual PIs on what's the best practices for discussing this topic, and maybe get some of those people that are in that group of, you know, non-PIs that have looked at it, believe it, and then maybe have a, you know, write a recommendation letter saying that, you know, this sounds correct to me. You know, everything that they're providing made sense. They even had, you know, an audio spotlight and a EEG machine and a, you know, a couple of repeatable experiments that lend credibility to this topic. And then from there, you want to, you know, you approach it with, you don't want you to be the only one providing this information. You want it to sound like there are 100 or more people who are discussing this topic. So it's not just, you know, the credibility of one person who's trying to put forth the information. And then especially, you know, if you have a police badge, you know, also like the internet, and then he, you know, he'll present himself as a, you know, law enforcement, and he'll try to approach somebody and tell them to go in there and get a baby out of this, you know, from this woman that's in a market who happens to be like a paid actor, kind of a setup. And they can get people to actually steal a baby, you know, just by flashing the badge. So there's a science behind the
authority
figure. You know, get them to steal. It's not even real, but it's like a doll, you know, they're getting them to steal a dang baby.
But what we're doing with me is satellites, you know, the voice, you can actually hear this loud voice in the air, and people are just startled by it, and they cooperate with it. And there's no live person there. There's just this voice in the air. And you track onto a cell and radio, and you hear this operator's voice, and, oh, I better cooperate with this. You know, and it's God talking to me, like voice of God. There's no God talking to the people. Believe me.
Well, yeah, actually, that happened, and they motivated a whole bunch of Muslims to surrender by a so-called voice of God that told them.
Okay.
Yeah. I think
same thing, though.
So,
issues that similar. You know, I had one of my aunts said, oh, you know, I heard something about this in North Carolina where they were, you know, warehousing people at mental institutions. And then there was another group that, you know, they forced sterilized some people. And, you know, they talked about it in high school and how it was wrong for them to do this, you know, because it was kind of a eugenics agenda. And they sued them and they won. And so, it's, yeah, I've heard something like this. So they, everybody, you know, they you get little pieces of good information from people you talk to. So it's just a matter of, you know, kind of getting them into a plan. And if it doesn't work, you know, back off and try something new. You know?
It's also
yeah.
The...
I photocopied, I took a JPEG image of both guinea pigs and a project still catcher, and I just got the cover of the book, and I've made up an information packet just that can go into like a 13 by, you know, whatever the standard mailer size is, flexible manila envelope, and I just shove that thing full of it. So, like, I think it can get, you know, 12 or 13 ounces under a first glass stamp, and I just put, you know, and I think I mailed up, I don't know, like 1,500 or 2,000 of those. And, you know, every newspaper and all the governors and, you know, every student counselor of the top 100 schools. And, you know, it's just that information. You know, you never know. It might get in the right hand. You know, if that information gets in the right hand, you know, especially like me, you know, for me, that's how I found this program. Was, you know, somebody mentioned it. A teacher in high school mentioned something about it, and I read a little something about it in a book here, and then just I kind of put all these pieces together.
She made a fist when I wasn't supposed to. And if I feel like I'm being threatened, you know, for with serious bodily harm, I will fucking stab him. You understand me? It's my new knife, by the way.